Hello, this is Lazarus at Telecom Tech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining class-based tunnel selection within the framework of MPLS-TE. Tech talk doesn't have to be complicated. I do my best to make networking and telecom easy to understand, so you can learn without frustration. If this helps, don't forget to like, subscribe, and ring the bell for updates. Now, over the past few videos, we've gone through several configuration features of MPLS-TE. We've configured MPLS-TE itself, the OSPF-TE underlay, the RSVP-TE mechanism, and we've established an LSP tunnel. We've examined how to route traffic down that tunnel in various ways, and we've also explored different methods of affecting the path a TE tunnel will take through the topology. In this video, we'll take a look at a feature called class-based tunnel selection. When there are multiple tunnels that are configured within the head-end router, CBTS is a feature that allows the head-end router to choose which tunnel will be used to forward traffic based on the EXP values found in the MPLS header of each packet. Now, I know all of this needs a bit of explanation, so let's get going. Now, let's say we have two tunnels that go from this head-end router, PE1, to this tail-end router, PE2. When a packet arrives on PE1 from CE1, for example, and it's destined for some destination behind PE2, the MPLS configuration within the PE1 router will add an MPLS header in preparation for sending it over the MPLS topology. This is normal, this is what we've seen so far, nothing new here. Now, when it does so, it includes the EXP field we see here in the MPLS header. Now, CBTS will examine that EXP value to decide which tunnel will be used to forward the traffic. Now, what is an EXP value? EXP is a field within the MPLS header that is used for the purpose of quality of service. It's a 3-bit value, so it ranges from 0 to 7 in decimal values. By default, the value is 0, but you can use various QoS mechanisms to change this. Now, there are a few prerequisites for CBTS to work. First of all tunnels involved in a CBTS mechanism must have the same head-end and tail-end routers. CBTS will not work if your tunnels have different tail-end routers. Secondly, all of the tunnels between the head-end and tail-end routers that participate in CBTS are known as a bundle. A bundle can have two or more tunnels. And finally, the path taken by each tunnel in a bundle can be the same or can be different based on the various constraints configured in each tunnel. So, for example, tunnel 1 can go this way, and tunnel 2 can go this way, and CBTS will still work just fine. Now, note that CBTS is not actually a routing mechanism. You still need some sort of routing configured to route traffic down your tunnels. It's more akin to a QoS mechanism, choosing a tunnel that is more appropriate to the requirements of the specific EXP value of your traffic. Now, to configure CBTS, what we do is we configure what is known as a master tunnel. This tunnel is an entity that we create, and we assign the underlying TE tunnels to it as member tunnels. The configuration of the master tunnel is the same as the TE tunnels. We also use the master tunnel in our routing configurations, so we direct traffic down the master tunnel and not the member tunnels. And CBTS will then distribute the packets across the member tunnels based on the EXP values. Now, here we have two tunnels between the same head-end and tail-end routers, PE1 and PE2, respectively. Here you can see the configuration of each tunnel. The parameters for each tunnel can be different. For example, I've reserved a bandwidth of 1,000 on tunnel 1 and a bandwidth of 750 on tunnel 2. Now, we may add many different constraints to each individual tunnel based on the requirements of the type of traffic that each tunnel will be carrying. But for now, let's just keep these differences here. For more details on these tunnel configuration commands, take a look at some of the previous videos in this playlist. Now let's assign the EXP value that each of our tunnels will be serving. This is done like so. Let's use a value of 1 for tunnel 1 and a value of 2 for tunnel 2. That's it. Now each tunnel is associated with a specific EXP value. Now let's create our master tunnel. Our master tunnel will be tunnel 3, and the rest of the configuration is the same as that of our member tunnels. We use the same loopback 0 as our local tunnel termination point, and we use the same tunnel destination of the loopback address of PE2. Now these EXP bundle commands are the key to creating this master tunnel. We specify that our tunnel is the master using the EXP bundle master command, and then we specify which tunnels belong to this bundle, and we do so with these two commands here. Now one other thing you can see here is that I have used autoroute announce to route traffic down our master tunnel. So to use CBTS, routing must be configured on the master tunnel. Once a packet is routed down our master tunnel, only then will CBTS kick in to determine whether it will use tunnel 1 or tunnel 2, depending on the configured EXP value. And that's all there is to it. Let's take a look at the results. Let's look first at the master TE tunnel. By examining this tunnel, we can see that it has a status of master, as expected, and it has two member tunnels. You can also see the EXP values assigned to each tunnel. Now, to test this configuration, we can issue a ping and assign a specific EXP value to that ping. Now, when we use our ping command, we can set a specific type of service value, which is a value used for QoS marking. These TOS values, when routed over an MPLS topology, are mapped to MPLS EXP values, and those values are used to populate the EXP field found within the MPLS header. Now, without going too much into detail, a TOS value of 32 in our ping will translate to an EXP value of 1. So by pinging using a TOS value of 32, this ping should have been routed down the master tunnel and sent via tunnel 1, which has an EXP value of 1. So let's issue our ping with a TOS of 32. And let's see which tunnel was used. To do so, we look at our tunnel 1 on PE1. Here you can see that tunnel 1 was used for 50 packets, so it looks like the correct tunnel was used for our pings. Let's try some more pings using an EXP value of 2. Now to achieve this, we use a TOS value of 64 in our ping, which will be translated to an EXP value of 2. Now this time, we'll be pinging 40 packets. Let's look at the result on tunnel 2. Here you can see that 40 packets were indeed routed via this tunnel. So we have now confirmed that the correct EXP values are selecting the correct tunnels. So now we have successfully configured CBTS for our bundle of tunnels from PE1 to PE2. Now CBTS is usually used for QoS-based traffic steering, where one tunnel may be optimized with its RSVP bandwidth and affinity flags for VoIP traffic, which requires low latency and high reliability, while another tunnel may be simply used for best effort traffic, like web browsing traffic. Or CBTS may be useful in a multi-tenant situation where one ISP uses one particular tunnel which has a particular SLA, while another ISP uses another tunnel with a completely different SLA. And those SLAs are what determine the parameters and constraints and affinity flags and other configurations that are used to define each particular tunnel. So there are many different applications for CBTS, and if you consider the vast number of tunnels that you can include in such a bundle, you can see how this is very scalable for a wide variety of traffic types and requirements. For now, I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. If you have any questions or feedback, feel free to leave a comment. I'm always happy to read them and to respond. And please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.